This is Paul Effie's fault.
Yes.
She suggested that, quite rightly, that I should cover the back history of the firm and the story, the narrative, and I've based it with Emma's help. Is Emma here? No. With Emma's help, she's somewhere out there. On the four books that we've done, and the four books are Place, which we did last time, up to 81, and this is Collage and Context, which we are doing today, which is 81 to 91. And Collage and Context actually is a combination of these two books. We merge them. It isn't, they were both very good books, so we combine them. Can I have the first slide? Yes, so that's Collage and Context, 81-91. And we went to 81, we went to 81 and 81-91, 91-2001, and 2001-2011. We hopefully will do 1-21. That's the two books that were merged to create this book. And that's the period. That came out in 84-85. That came out in 91-92. And they were both by Academy editions, so that made it easier to bring them together. Next one. I covered last time Place, and I went up to the split between me and Grimshaw. That's me with the car. In 63, that's Nick in a Sergeant Pepper outfit in about 67, 68. And we were in partnership together from 65 to 80. So it was 15 years. So it was quite a long time. Next one. And I covered last time the emergence of the new practice. Started in 1980 and continued without any partners because I think I was a bit put off partners by the split with Grimshaw and so I went from 18 to 2010 roughly with no one else having equity, but that's all changed now. But initially, we had quite a lot of coverage, and it went right through the 80s. And I covered this a bit last time, and there's the egg cups and the man who took high tech out to play. We were written by Dan Sujik in the Sunday Times colour supplement, which at that time was an unusual part of the colour supplement because it was the only one that people read. Nowadays, you open a newspaper and all kinds of colour supplements fall out. But at that time, it was still the primary colour supplement. Next one. And I went to Hong Kong to do a competition, which we won, but then another architect took it over. But we went there, and I went with two members of staff, Mike Glass and Joe Fergers, in 1980. Actually, just before Christmas, and we stayed there 6 weeks. And while, just before I went, I met Peter Jay and others who were bidding for TVAM. And their bid was successful for breakfast television, but they hadn't tied up, they weren't very good businessmen, and they hadn't tied up the site. And so I volunteered to look for a site, and we discovered through the chief planning officer of Camden, this car repair shop, which was quite big in Camden Town. And we then proceeded to do TVM, and we, Peter Jay said he wanted, he sat on an aeroplane next to somebody who persuaded him that it should be design build. He came back full of design build, so I found a contractor, Wiltshire's, who then became our client. So we actually were involved in the commercial side of the project. And we built it all, including the site purchase, all the furniture, all the equipment, £42.50 a square foot, which I know is cheap today, but it was cheap then. And so we were involved in the whole commercial deal. And it basically was a building which you see there, which is an old shed, a 30 shed, and that was the build that was new. And I really enjoyed the fact that the front was different to the back and different to the middle. In fact, we had three job architects, and I absolutely delighted in the fact that we expressed things differently. And it became famous for the egg cups on the back. And there were 12 of them. We had to build a little house to have a dozen eggs and egg cups. We had three job architects, Simon Sturgis here, Clive Wilkinson there, and John Leatherland on the back. And Joe Fogers in overall control. Next one. And you at the front, you wouldn't know it was a conversion, and we had a lot of fun doing that. This was, the profile metal was inspired by a building I saw on the on City Road. I don't know what happened to it, but it was a building that had profile metal in bands, and we organized it so there were different bands, and we extruded the letters, rather like Italian futurism. And Simon Sturgis was brilliant at this front facade. He's now running a sustainability consultancy, and he's going to come in to give a talk and seminar. But he does, I met him on the Common Ching reunion, and he said, I've forgotten all about architecture, it's a mug's game. And he had 40, 50 staff, and now has 15, and he's really happy doing sustainability. He's a consultant on, he's an expert on embodied energy. But he was absolutely extraordinary on this facade. Next one. And the interior was Clive Wilkinson and others too. We designed, we discovered that you could laser cut linoleum, or its modern equivalent. We did the stairs, and it was actually an adaptation of the existing interior of the shed. We designed this reception desk. That's our my personal secretary at the time, Kim, and she was very very narcissistic. She was pretty, but she wanted to be in. When we had photographs of buildings, she always appeared as the model. Dressed up, went out, and you'll see many, many other buildings. She's the receptionist, whatever. And this reception desk was a tour de force. It was a wonderful creation by Clive Wilkinson. Again, the linoleum and all the bits and pieces. And a dwarf came in one day, and the receptionist said he was looking up her legs. And Angela Rippon and others among the board of TVAM said it must go. And overnight it was sawn up into little bits, bang, and her middle desk was put there instead of her. And I walked in one day, I said, where's the desk? They said, oh, it's little bits, and banged and went out. And that was it. We had a narrative in the inside. We went from, the idea was that it was a garden, and it was all from east to west. So in the east we had, the green room was in a Japanese temple. This was the Mesopotamia or Middle East island and ziggurats. And then we had right through to the desert and the Arizona and the far west. And then we had a mirror so that you could see the whole thing. And I went back 10 years later, and they were still telling the same story to tourists and visitors, which I liked a lot. This is an invention of Clive's, where the light shines up, but it shines on the cone, so the cone becomes the solid point of all the light. Next one. And these were Clive Wilkinson's drawings. There's the reception desk. And he had a great time with linoleum, laser cut, and lights, and furniture, and so on. Next one. And at the back, we had, we kept the wall. This was the house we added to get a dozen eggs. The eggs, they painted all these gray. They took the house down recently, and the egg cups were, we put the idea of the egg cups to the client, to Wilshire's and to TVM bosses, and they said, that's too flippant, and we won't pay for them. So we paid for them ourselves. They cost £100 each. So the egg cups were £1,200. We got the builders to do starter bars, so we could slot them on and then attach them. We in the office, Steve Smith and John Leatherman went up to fix the egg cups. These were for health and safety, and installed them. When they took the egg cup down, they painted all the others grey, and we, Bishop and I saw a catalogue. It was entered, this egg cup, which was in the front reception, was in for sale at the Christie's auction, and we, I asked Emma. Emma, are you there? I asked Emma to bid by phone, I told her that we wouldn't go higher than £2,500. But she said, you have the egg cup, but not the price you want. We paid £5,400 for the egg cup that originally had cost £100, and we had paid for it. So. At the same time, we did Limehouse Studios, which I did this little sketch of Gulliver and Oliver, because it was a big banana warehouse. It was all part of Canary Wharf. And that is a drawing of the existing building, and these are the little add-ons. And I compared it to Gulliver with little add-ons. And these, that's the warehouse behind. You can see the warehouse here. It's a big corner. It's a really big warehouse. And we added these bits on. We did the birds, which Clive Wilkinson designed, but the rest was designed by the team. This was all in stone enamel work, with failed tiling in here. It was a really interesting building, but they wouldn't sign the lease, because if you see up there, we had added on flat room, because for a television studio you needed a lot of flat. So we added on that on, and they would not sign the lease and give planning consent, London Docklands Development Corporation, because we built it, and according to them, a metre too high than the legal agreement and the planning consent. So we were really worried, because they would have to shut down and so on. So it was very modest height. It's about 5 stories high. They pulled it down to build the tallest building in Europe, which was Canary Wharf Tower, which is the madness of planning in this country. And the Canary Wharf Tower sits on the site of this building. It lasted only 5 or 6 years. Next one. That's the interior. We based it on diagonals, and we had a maypole in the middle, and we designed all the furniture. This is all the fabric we designed. We actually designed the fabric in-house. There's Kim again. She set up an accountancy consultancy, financial, didn't she? Next one. And there are several models here, and this is the model in the middle one there, this one here, which was Fincher Street. And this was a middle bank, and it was a really interesting building. These are drawings by Clive Wilkinson and the team. That were my doodles that began it all. It was on this site, on the very nose of a convergence of streets. And we made a lot of the three entrances, one, two, and one, third one around the other side. And we did a lot of tiering and hierarchy of elements of the architecture, and we really tried very hard with this one. It's now been radically altered, and we applied to English Heritage to list it, but it was too late. And the architects in their submission said that they wanted to remove all the those awful postmodern elements. And I thought that's very, very, very fascinating. How fashions change, and how it's the time of rediscovery of postmodernism, and yet it almost as if the moment you're actually experiencing people wanting to remove it, you know you're almost arriving. And Adam Furman and I have been writing this book for the RIBA Journal on revisiting postmodernism, and we got the John Lutram pumping station in the cover, which was a big debate with the RIBA. They felt that why this building, and not, they wanted microgrids, and I wanted the British building. But last night, English Heritage declared it was the first true listing of a British postmodern building. I think. Is that right?
I think. Unthreatened building.
Unthreatened building, yes. It's the first voluntary
building are.
John Intrum was the architect, and it was extraordinary. Anyway, we didn't succeed on this one. We had a letter from the dean of Bolton Borough, which was truly shocking. It was probably written by somebody who was heritage, saying this wasn't a building of significance. It's kind of architects today, because the 30-year listing is catching up. It used to be that listed buildings were 18th and 17th century and before. Now it's 30 years, and you know, if you hang around a bit, you find buildings are being listed, and it's almost like end of year report card to read that your building could have tried harder, it wasn't very good, and so on. It's a bit depressing. Next one. This was another one which may be listed, and these are my doodles here and there. It's the Henley Regatta headquarters. I really enjoyed the fact that it had three functions, all very different. You had a boathouse at the very bottom level. You had a clubhouse, which was very posh and entered from the street. The boathouse was entered from the river. And there was, in the roof, in the attic, was the club secretary's flat. So that was right, and that entrance was on the far side. So we had three very different functions, all expressed with different entrances and so on. And this is the boathouse. What happened was that the racetrack, it only lasts a week. I don't understand how it is. It's a weird kind of ritual. But they go every year and put the posts to mark the course in the same holes that they had last year. They find the holes, they put the posts in, and they take the posts out, and they store the posts in the boathouse. It's not actually boats that they store, it's actually the posts on the course. And they fit in the course all the way down the River Thames. It's nearly a mile long. Next one. And this is the boathouse. There's the bridge next door. We match the bridge by having a rusticated base. We have a clubhouse on top. We did flamboyant colours, because that's how we saw rowing and the regalia of the rowers and so on. And next one. And that's the bridge there, and you can see we continue the bridge across. This is the clubhouse, and this is at night. And we did restored the building. It had a balcony and restoration works to the starting course. So we did the end of the course at the start of the course. We had, it was 1984-85, we went to what was then, we thought it was an extraordinary amount of consultation. We went to 25 different bodies to present the scheme. Next one. And then, because we were into urbanism and urban design, Colin Avery told me the story that he was rung up by head of Graco Developers, asking him who he'd recommend, who was an urbanist and an architect. And he said, I think Terry Farrell, you should be. I met Geoffrey Wilson, head of Graco, and that was the days when somebody said to you, all right, you could be the architect. And we took it for granted, and we set about it, and they built it. That was, you know, nowadays you have to compete for each successive stage. There is tendering and competition and But it was an urban scheme. There had been a temporary roof that had lasted 85 years, believe it or not. The original barrel vault had collapsed, and so we then renovated the station. We did the piles down. The whole structure is built on this chap goes up, this chap goes up to an arch, and it's all lead suspended. It's an extraordinary structure because it's all suspended, including a 5 meter or 7 meter cantilever at the sides. The only thing that comes down to the ground is the escape stairs. And Neil Bennett's here. Neil negotiated all the strategic moves on this building, about cores outside and so on. But we had a basket load of planning games. They weren't called planning games then. This was before all these things were institutionalized. But we developed a coin market and a theatre, and we restored the gardens. We had another entrance to the station. We did up the underneath undercroft of the station, and we also created the streets, and we replaced the railings that had been demolished in the early mid 20th century to widen the road, and we replaced the railings there that had from photographs. So we did a lot of urban improvements, and we even did ideas for the for improving the pedestrian crossings of the Humphrey Bridge. It was extraordinarily complex because there's a lot of tube stations underneath and tube lines. These columns were 100 feet, 30 meters long, and when there are only 18 of them, 9 pairs, and when they went down to each one, it was during the miners' strike, and the miners came down from Yorkshire and Northumberland and dug these. It was very, very good luck for the developer and the contractor, because the miners were moonlighting on our project, and they dug out the it through the Thames clay, and it was about 25 feet in that old one. It was so it's 8, 9, 10 meters across the base of the pile, and they had a bottoming out party whenever they completed the digging for each one. So. I didn't go down there. I felt it was too claustrophobic. But we restored the water gate by Nigo Jones, and rebuilt the bandstand. We did a lot of things around the building. Next one. And that's the building. That's the building above the station now. It has been the whole of the interiors has been rethought by T.P. Bennett, and they've done a wonderful job. It was fairly minimal in terms. Next one. And this is Villiers Street. They have a very, very nice model, a big model upstairs. Couldn't bring it down today. But we designed it at the same time as we were making the model. It was designed on the model. Next one. That's the clock. You saw it in the previous picture. It was, I think it was a project manager who said, you could tell an architect's designing the clock because you can't tell the time. And I think it was true, because it was totally clear for us on perspective. I think it was. And the numbers were written on, and there were two hands on each side. But you could see right through it, so you didn't know quite where the hands were. so we had to introduce an opaque element in between. It was let by the developers successfully during the late 80s recession. And we nicknamed this Banker's Leap because of the kind of threat of suicides at that time with the failure of the banking system. Next one. This is the interiors on the ground floor. And these have all gone, unfortunately. But we work with various artists on lighting. This was a waterfall to kill by white sound, and sound of the trains, which did work. But today it's all gone because they wanted to go straight through to the lifts. Next one. And these are the recreation. That is the Charing Cross, which everyone thinks is the original Charing Cross. It's actually, it stood on the site of Trafalgar Square. It was moved by, demolished by John Nash when he improved Trafalgar Square. And that's a Victorian imagination of what Charing Cross might be like. And Charing Cross is not, the station is not on the site. But that we saw from old photographs, we recreated the front railings and the lights. We had a theatre, which was a very famous Players' Theatre. And we did the station interior, which you can still see as you go in these giant chandeliers, which were inspired by the Moscow Underground. Next one. We got involved in various urban projects, but particularly counter proposals. And this was for sale. This was a mansion house tower that was proposed by Peter Palumbo with a square in front. And we proposed the richness of the retaining the existing buildings. And we did a lot of drawings and a lot of work on this. This is before the Sterling building that's there at the moment. But I think that we did a very, very good job of advocacy. And we worked on advocacy, and I appeared at the planning inquiry on behalf of the city. Next one. And that's the platform, which is contemporary with, or a little bit later than, Commingue Triangle, which is inspired by. And I've arranged some pedestrian crossings and how the choreography of crossings and how that could be enhanced and part of the public realm. And I went against the square and the empty gesture of the square. Next one. And also we did a Paternoster scheme. Practiced and exhibited a lot of advocacy. That was the medieval cathedral and the street plan. This is the St. Paul's with the square, Paternoster Square. That's the square as it evolved. That's the Holford buildings that were then built. And this was a recreation of the square and our master plan. And this is what, more or less, what was built. Next one. At Alban Gate, we looked at the Crickle Gate, which was a creeping gate, which was an entrance to the Barbican, as we saw. And these are done by Clive Wilkinson and Doug Streeter at that time. And these were all the various combinations of drawings and ideas that led to the eventual elevations and the architects that resulted. Next one. And we went for a much more is more ordinary. We developed an architecture of straight strip windows and office expression. But this was the entry to Barbican. This was the shopping centre. As it was above a street, it was extremely complicated structure because it had no rigidity. And then had an external truss, which had atriums, which were bowed out in this section and recessed in that section. So we had a structure that was cat's cradle. Also recreated a square at the back, we made the back building symmetrical with a square. We completely reconfigured the square and built housing around. The housing is not considered today by passers-by as being part of the project, but it was very much part of the, there's a small space there and a square there, which is Bunkle Square. Next one. And this is the cat's cradle structure, which you walk through, which is extraordinary physical manifestation of engineering. And I quite enjoyed that because it was the high-tech background of me and Grimshaw, but also it was making it into a formalized gateway and entrance and an architectural expression of symmetry and formality. Next one. And this is the square at the back. These were the houses. Quite Luchinesque. This is the small square. That's a block of flats. And these are individual houses. And that's the entrance to the car park, which sits below this area. Next one. We also did Tobacco Dock at that time, which is a grade one listed building. It was in bits, and we consolidated all the bits. It's a magnificent building. This is the Great Church by Hawksmoor. And this, I think that's it in the distance there. And we spent a lot of time thinking of how we did shops, fitting them into the lower arches and the brick vaults and into the trees of the cast iron element above. It failed as a shopping centre very quickly afterwards. Actually, our client was, those were the days, our client was a man who was a circus performer on horses. And he went to the Tower of London and tried to persuade them that because he was getting older and he couldn't do the circus horse tricks, he couldn't continue with that as he was getting older. He tried to persuade them that the Tower of London to have jousting in the moat, and he was told, no, there's an empty building at the road and you could hold your jousts in there. He went in there and there was an enormous problem. That was Darlington, which was the back door. And he went to the back. The back said, we can't fund this jousting. We can fund a shopping centre. He said, well, I don't know anything about shopping centres. So he then got money and he became an expert in festival shopping, which he then gave talks all around the world. And money was pouring in. And then it all went bust about 5 years later. And I went to National Trust headquarters and And I went to the desk and the security man there, and he said, please sit down, and somebody will come and I'll show you. And then he said, you don't recognise me, do you, Terry? And he said, I have no idea. He said, I'm in. And he was the same man. He was now a security guard. And he'd gone from riding horses in the circus to being the expert on festival shopping that the bank showered money on, and he lectured around the world, to bankrupt, and it was a security guard. And he was perfectly cheerful. He said, I'm perfectly happy with that. But that was the caravan piece. Excellent. And we spent a lot of time on this was the vaults. This was we made this into shopping. These were the wooden piles. We kept a wooden pile, didn't we? Gary was.
I've got it.
You got it, have you? We got one of those wooden piles. So you have it.
I've got it. Same.
It's a wooden thing with a metal sleeve on the bottom, isn't it?
Yeah.
And these are very, very fine structure. Next one. And the next one. We worked on other protest schemes. This was showing how Hammersmith Roundabout could be rethought, and the bus station elementalized, and so on. Next one. And we also got involved, again for SAVE and English Heritage, in ideas for Spitalfields Market. And what we proposed is that they keep all the surrounding low buildings, 30s buildings. I think this is the wrong way around. But that's one side, this is the other side. And they built the new offices in this part here. And so we kept the old market, and that is more or less as it actually is now. The old market, and these buildings have all been retained. And Norman Foster gives the same talk, arguing that he thought of it all in the first place. But we acted for SAVE England's Heritage and others to illustrate it. We did it all for free. But it developed our ability to demonstrate conservation and new build approach. It also developed our advocacy, because we, along with this, we did a lot of sketches and drawings and so on. Next one. And we did, this is King's Cross, the goods yard. And this is interesting, because we were in the last two with Norman Foster, who proposed a big park in the centre and the buildings around it. We proposed that they kept the granary and they made a route through here. And I think that there's a lot of what was built in today in that scheme. And I think it's South Bank too. When you get involved in master planning and ideas for London or for any city, it gets absorbed, and it's like passing the baton on, and people don't remember quite whose ideas were, but that's collective, and you have to recognise that. This is East Putney. We did the station up, and actually we. It got me into the idea that you can get an enormous amount of return from photo booths, flower stalls, and newspaper kiosks, because that paid for the whole thing. And when Piers, a few years later, was doing what is now called Purple Island, what is it?
Turquoise.
Turquoise Island.
Yeah.
Which is scheme that Piers did had...
A small road.
It was basically a toilet building, revamped. And I suggested the flower stall, because that was the link. That's what made me remember how much money you could get from small stalls. And the most successful outcome of this, I think that's mostly removed now, but the most successful outcome was Piers' scheme at Turquoise Island. Next one. That was the drawings we did for King's Cross. Next one. This is Comanching, which has just been listed. Gary was the job architect for a large part of this. That was it before. This was it afterwards.
Not quite finished.
It wasn't quite finished, you had.
They didn't once really explain why, because they owned that whole building. That's why it was not the last piece.
Yes.
They were last to go.
We had a get together of all the architects involved in it 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
That was a really nice get together. We should have a slide of that next one. This is the interior. This the landscaping, I developed a huge respect for anybody trying to do stonework. And we had wonderful dialogue 2 weeks ago about the carpenters, the stonemasons, and and all the builders that entered into it and the spirit of it. But we cleared out all the buildings in the middle, made a new entrance. This is teaching us a bit about what we're doing in Grosvenor today, because we had entrances at the back to get to the upper floors, so that the shops occupy the front street, the main street. Next one. This is the common gym signature, which we use throughout. And we enjoyed very much doing the detailing, which is still pretty well cared for today. Next one. Next one. That's the corner building. The two corner buildings were Simon Sturgis. Next one. This is Brindley Place, which we... You did the restaurant in we did it for Rosemore, and they went bust, and Arjun took it over. But they stuck to more or less to our plans. Next one. That's your building, yes. Next one. And then in 1982, we entered a competition. I was rung up in that competition, it never happened. To open competitions. I was rung up by the RIVA president. I'm not sure if it was on the roof at that time. He rang me up and said, "Nobody's going into this competition." I said, "Well, that sounds like the kind of competition I would like to enter." So we went into this is the scheme we did. These were all we tiered up from the front to the back. We did houses on the front. We did offices behind. It was all, as someone described it, it was like seats at the theatre. There was they selected three architectural schemes that were then preserved. They were then displayed. The three of them were displayed on the site in the marquee. The developer then was chose which of the three he liked. It then got special planning consent by a called an SDO, a special development board. It went through Parliament just like that, because Michael Heseltine was behind it, and it got planning consent. And then the developer went bust. Surprise, surprise. So the site was split into two. We acted for Regalian on that one, of which Regalian became MI6. We acted for the people that bought that bit, so we were ended up being commissioned for both sides. We went to planning inquiry on both, separately on both sides. We won both of them, and that then was sold to Barclay Homes. We just did an outline scheme and got planning consent for residential use. But this one, we went to appeal for housing, but by the time we got to the results of the planning inquiry, the bottom had fallen out of the residential market. So our client was looking around for another use, and he came across the government looking for a home for MI6. Next one. And this is that's the residential one, which I think Gary, you did, didn't you?
Yeah.
And then we then did an office scheme, which was based on a grid. I just been to Norway, and I was very impressed by Trondheim and Trondheim University and so on. And we did a scheme for offices that could be speculative offices, and that was our manifestation of that scheme. And then the MI6 came along and said they wanted 12 metres wall to wall. So that became that simply because there was so narrow wall to wall, so narrow plan. And so it shot up. But the plan is very interesting. We've actually got four atriums internally, and then four atriums externally. So it was all about these atriums, and a step back from the river, so that plan became that plan became that plan. And all the cores are on the outside edge, but found a way because the site wasn't truly rectangular. So that discipline gave us a very strong structure, architectural structure, to build the building. The next one. And I really like the idea that the cores were made of glass, even though they're solid. And the solid is the window bit. It's a bit perverse, but we had a lot of fun with that. This is actually built on the piles, so that the River Thames is not interrupted. It flows underneath the public gardens. And that public gardens is open to the public, and so on. Next one. And next one. Well, you can see this today. Next one. And the final scheme, bringing you right up to date. This is, I came across this building complex being sold in 1984, and I was walking, I lived in Maida Vale. I went down to the market on Saturdays, and I was passing by and I saw a sales site and I inquired about it. And he said you could buy 1,000 square feet chunks. So I said, oh, I'll copy down for 5,000 square feet. And I kept in touch with him, and he said, I've got to sell the rest first. I said, how are you going to do that? And I demonstrated to him that you can't actually sell 5,000 square feet or 10,000. You couldn't do that because you had to partition it off, and you had to have fire escapes and so on. So he said, can you help me do this? So I said, give me the list of the 5,000 or 10,000 square feet purchases that you've got already. So I then got a lot of people together, and on one day in May 85, I collected together 19 people who had checks and contracts. signed, and by 5 o'clock we were able to exchange contracts, and we got the premises at the top next door, which is my flat, which we got free, and I bought the rest. We didn't have any money, which I didn't let on to the vendor. But we managed to get the whole lot, 65,000 square feet, at £10 a square foot, which was kind of ridiculous. But we had to then put all the division walls in, and the fire escapes, and the means escape, and the lifts and so on. But this was an entire office at that time. There's me, you see me. There's me. Are you in there, Gary?
Yeah, just behind.
Is that you there?
Yeah.
There's Neil, there's Gary, there's me, there's Simon Sturgis.
Maggie says.
No, I'm not in that one.
Steve Smith ran to the delayed timer and then ran back. So he's, and that's. We thought we'd take a before and after, but we cut a hole in the floor, so we couldn't take it to a floor. And also, the 20 or so staff increased to 100 plus in next to no time. So, but that was what it was like, and that's as it is now. Next one. And there were three buildings, and we added all this stuff. That was the original design of the tops. This is the Spitfires and the wings. And that's on the next one. And that's as it is today. So that explains where we are. These were stained brickwork, which we were really into staining bricks at that time. This is all Cantara. Those are the wings, and the Spitfires on the roof. We had a lot of fun, and the W20 windows, they were still manufacturing. I think they were all replacement windows. They were new windows. I've asked Piers here tonight, and Piers is... Piers is very intertwined with our lives at that time, several buildings, and still is, because there's a lot of common and the housing there. But Piers is going to describe his story, parallel story.
Yeah, that's daunting after it all, it all turned out to be so modest. Hey, yes, while they were busy demolishing your Limehouse studios here, we were plotting with one of our East End house building clients this item, which Cascades, which of course was outrageous. It was 20 whole stories high. In an area that was, the LDDC had quite imagined was going to be more of this, which was Nick Lacey's version of Milton Keynes, fundamentally. And the yellow brick road was off up here, and it was all going to be very Tweety Pie. And my client and my partner Rex went to Hong Kong, both independently but at the same time, and came back and said, we're all just pissing in the wind, really. And why don't we try something here, which Rex designed. I didn't do, but we got us off to a bit of a start. He was the one who got the first crane onto a building site in our office. We started the office in 75, and this was around about 10 years later. This was built next. It's called Cascades. It's a riff on mill buildings with grain elevators, on warehouses and on ships. It's kind of an amalgam of many influences. It was also as if some old warehouse had got left behind here, some sort of remnants of a warehouse in this bit, and then an extruded up building where the in and out of the elevation was to do with having a bigger living room than bedrooms. And Rex had this idea that the living room should be bigger and therefore stick out more, so this gave this wavy form to the building. To protect the balconies, nobody gives such consideration anymore to buildings, but you know, along this walkway with the public, and we thought the balconies should have more protection at the bottom, so they're more enclosed, and then as they go up, they break out, and then because of the diagonal cutting across the wave, you get quite complex geometries, and you know, individual items, and these portholes in things, a flat element of this part. These are all south-facing terraces, so it was a raving success. It was all sold off plan. This was a whole new idea, selling off plan. And every taxi driver in London, just about, who were East Enders, bought one for their kids. That's what this building represented. Rex didn't have much of a head for heights, and so he thought you'd need an enclosure once you got up here. You really needed a little feeling of safety, so that's why they appeared suddenly on the top of the building. And so, you know, we hadn't really done a large building before, so just about every idea anybody had had in the office went into this building. It kind of forced into the building. The client wanted a swimming pool because of it, you know, to bring people in. It was the first of the sort of, it's a kind of half a hotel, partly a living place, pleasure principle, a building based on a kind of pleasure principle rather than a kind of worthy architectural, got to be part of the background of the city. You know, housing, it has to be the sort of the tertiary activity, and all at once, we got the idea that actually housing could be fun, it could be exciting, it could be a big element of the city which stood up and said, I'm here. And this was, of course, the me generation in the 80s. This is when me was discovered, when people discovered that they were me. And we, however, were kind of 60s people who got old enough to actually build buildings. So we were kind of 60s-like attitude. The 80s was the built 60s, if you like. Nobody in the 60s really got around to building the 60s because they were still building the wall. And they were still building brutalism and rough and tough. And so the sort of gaiety of the 60s actually turned out in architecture in about the 80s. Next. The escape stair goes down the, and it's a really fabulous escape stair to walk it, or to actually dance down, because you go down here, round here, down there, round there, round there. So in a fire, you be extremely, you'd be very cheerful. And so when you look down to the bottom, you can see the swimming pool. So there's safe, there's water at the bottom. Swimming pool is a little bit modest, but anyway, there was a pool, and you could go down the spire with the escape stair and go in the pool. And the exercise, of course, would go back up again to your flat next. And that got itself onto the cover of the phone book. If you ever wanted to be pop architects, this was the sort of ultimate accolade, because you wouldn't know what a phone book is anymore, but a phone book was the London phone directory, which was given to every single telephone owner in London, which meant that there was more of them than there were Bibles. It was the biggest print run in Britain was the London phone book. And we were on A to K with Cascades. And next, we were on L to Z with China Wharf, which we also designed. So A to K plus L to Z equals CZWG. China Wharf is also on the river, but in a kind of conservation area, a bit near the Tower Bridge. And next, China Wharf was actually under the LWC, whereas Cascades was, we got planning through the Town Hamlets planning. Luckily, a guy called Ian Lazell from the AA was in Town Hamlets planning. And while his boss was away, he slipped it through. he just slipped it through in the middle of the summer when all the was on holiday, the councillors were on holiday, was on holiday, the planning commission, the planning committee was down to about four people, and he just slipped it through. This one stood in the river as well. We put some piles in the river, rather like my five. We can't, we'd never be allowed to do this anymore. And this building was built by Harry Neal, who also did Tobacco Dock afterwards. So we have a connection there. The great Harry Neal, who were the best building company in Britain, had everybody who worked, all the carpenters, the concrete men, the bricklayers, they were all Harry Neal men. There was no subcontractors. They were all worked for Harry Neal. And they did this immaculate workmanship. I mean, talk about you get your build, you've got your drawings exactly built, precisely. We specified some mastic between the steel and the concrete, and the guy sort of called us up and said, I can't fit the mastic in because the two are so precisely aligned. So you'll just have to put up with the fact that there'll be a paint joint between them. Obviously, this is a sort of Fellini-esque celebration of being on the river. There was a lot of warehouses. We were young. We weren't so respectful. We didn't say, ooh, well, it's an industrial field. we were like, where's the boats gone? Where's all those gorgeous liners? Where's all the gorgeous things that happen on the river? The river's empty. All the boats have gone away. And so we need to put back some of that sort of cheeriness. And I had a pair of compasses at the time. Of course, we all drew on drawing boards, as you gather at that moment. I had a pair of compasses. I was like, this could make a building. yeah, and it sort of sticks out of the water. Next. Because we had never done any buildings before, we had to do three totally different elevations. Just in case you never got another job. this is an inverted silo. This is sort of another type of storage, dockland storage. There were warehouses, there were silos, but it does twist the windows out, so they were looking slightly not directly across the courtyard. Did a sort of warehousey elevation facing downriver. This building shared the circulations. This conversion of this building was shared circulation, so it kind of actually enters through the loophole frame. And the brickwork was absolutely sort of immaculate. We put this colour reference onto this side because I was concerned about the amount of rainwater coming down and get dirty down. The white might get dirty down here. But in fact, what happened was pigeons nested up here and dropped shit down. So in fact, there's white marks. you calculate most things in architecture. Yeah. Nature gets the best of it. This is very popular with people who had red cars. They all moved in and chose cars to match the building, which is always kind of flattering. You can just see this slopes down, slides under there. BUJ Architects took this their offices. This building next is Scissors Flats, which I don't think anybody dares to attempt anymore, but it's the way that you get all the living rooms on the water side and all the bedrooms on the other side, and then you have passageways every alternate floor, and then the flats go up and cross over, so that guy's bedroom is that living room, and that living room has bedrooms there, and so on throughout, and there are hundreds of doors in the corridors, because not only do you have front doors to all the flats in the corridors, you have escape doors from the floor below, so this bedroom escapes up to this corridor, although it's entered from this corridor. So it's quite nutty, and what you trust is that you're getting the right electricity bill, because the electrician said he doesn't hardly know who's working with who. On site, when you can imagine, you've got empty shell and staircases everywhere, and the guy's like wiring. Yeah, well, apparently, nobody's really complained about their bills, so presumably somebody isn't getting all of them. But it was complicated, and we never tried to do it ever again. But we were young. Things must be all right. My tutor, in fact, at the AA had pioneered Scissors Flats. Jenny Jones, she pioneered Scissors Flats, so I was very enamored of it. Ted Hollenby tried to knock a floor off this building. He was the chief planning officer of the LNDC, and he wanted the floor off. And I said, Ted, but you invented Scissors Flats. And he went, oh, yes, 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 I did, yes. Well, you know, there has to be an even number. Oh, all right, old boy, you can keep the top floor up. yeah, this is one of those where the kitchen is sort of, well, it looks like we took the slice out and made a kitchen wall next. We got a job around the corner. The same client bought an old brewery site around the corner from China Wharf, but it was inland. It didn't have riverfront. And what it had was two pieces of land that were more or less equal size, and at one point were across the road from each other, narrow street. And this was one of those fantastic opportunity things to do a building which was either side of the street, which I still had my compasses jammed in the paper. So this time the circle was on plan. And Lutyens once said, I wonder what it would be like to live in a tea chest. And they papered a whole wall in silver. But I was thinking, I wonder how it's like to live in a gasometer. And that's so the inside of this, which is like either a very compressed crescent. I guess we thought that this area of Docklands had been carved from the solid, that these sort of London stock brick streets were as if someone had come with a cheese cutter and made the street after the buildings. And so it just seemed an interesting idea to make a bigger space in the same way, and then discover sort of a lapis lazuli quarry next. So we persuaded the client to spend an insane amount of money on these bricks, because at that time an average brick was 10p, and these bricks were a quid. And they came in boxes of four. You got four in a neat little box with subdivisions. You know, they were really looked after, because they were glazed bricks, they were really expensive. And they were from the bricklayer, the hoddy had to sort of hold it like this and give it to the bricklayer a silver salver. But the client, not only did he not sell half of the site off, which he'd threatened to, because he couldn't see how he could possibly enforce the other guys to do the blue circle, he also stumped up for the glazed bricks. I thought that these would look like vessels. They would sort of remind one of glazed pots with this shape here, with the sort of slight rim. And the minute they were built, the men on site called them the owls. And it just ruined it for me. Why would I see the owls? And this is the whole problem with kind of postmodern architecture with shapes, is that you think you've designed a shape, a certain shape, and then the someone else just sees a totally different shape in it, so then you have to think, okay. Not too much understanding of meaning. These were great. They were used in an opera. Janet, Street Porter, who ran a TV company out of Limehouse Studios. Here's another link. She was working in Limehouse Studios, and she invented an opera, which she filmed here. She'd been at the AA with me. And the hero, apparently anyway, leaps down all these balconies at one moment in the opera where he's escaping from the other lover. So the offsetting balcony is quite good if you think you may need to escape when the husband comes home. It's quite good to have offset balconies. I'm claiming that it's because they get more light. They get more daylight if they haven't got another balcony immediately above them. And these are narrow streets, so that was the reasoning. Next. Really quite nicely built. Next. And in the middle, our client insisted on putting a dray horse, because it had been where dray horses had pulled beer. So I had spent a long time persuading the highway authority that it would be a perfectly good idea to put a dray horse in the middle of a narrow street. And the guy says, no, it will cause accidents. And I was like, you can't, come on, bloody highway people. He insisted we had two bollards at the end, which lit up and had arrows on. Okay, all right, we'll do that. So anyway, the only car accident I've ever had in my life was when I was sharing some friends. I came round here, and I was rubbernecking, of course, and wasn't really looking. And I came round here and crashed into another woman in a car. And I got out and I said, look, I'm really sorry. And in fact, I had this horse put here. So, yeah, the highwayman was completely correct. And I've learned now to be nice to them. They know about turning circles. Next. There's some quite nice, quite sort of rich, chunky details. Crazy supports, next. And of course, the start of that whole business of building gardens, sort of imitating old mansion flats, which have been kind of forgotten, the shared garden, of the private balconies, which has now become the norm. Yeah. And this entrance hall that looks sort of glamorous, because again, these big blue circles gave a kind of instant glamour, where flats are becoming more like a hotel. They have a big swimming pool in this one, and cafes, and all the other things, and shops on the ground floor. Next. And some sumptuous marble, which got imported from America. Next. At the other end of the scale, we did modest stuff, studios. This was stuff that we tried to, for low rent, for artists, and we had a special use class, because in those days it was either offices or light industrial, and we had the special use class, studio use class, which we kind of invented and pushed through various local authorities, so that we could do bigger spaces, office spaces, but they had to be specifically for people in the arts. And Royalty Studios, developed by my then partner, Roger Zagolovich, Zed, CZWG, and he built these, and it's actually, it hasn't got a frame, it's entirely low bearing, with concrete plank floors, and just a staircase and outside wall, and you could do that for four floors. And it was cheap and cheerful. Next. We also worked on well, it wasn't actually a Grimshaw master plan, it was Bruce Gilbraith, who did a master plan out at Aztec West in Bristol, and they initially built a lot of tin stuff, and the developers then got into their heads, they'd like something more solid, and we took them at their word, and this is our project, Aztec West, and we, because it was all a drive-in, it was all about cars, we did a celebratory car office, where the car is king, the car carves the entrances out of the offices, and they wanted lots of separate but glamorous entrances, so we made these sort of huge semicircular inserts into the building, and this was almost the only building that me and my partner Rex both designed together, and I did the plans and he did the elevations, and it was almost total separation. As you know, I had the command of the compasses in the office, obviously, and so I did the plan with my compasses, and he got to do the elevations next. And they were sort of like Wells Fargo Bank in America. We wanted this sort of really strong kind of Louis Sullivan look, and he did windows that were sort of forbidden columns with base and capital, and used a striation of brickwork and pavement edges. Pavement edges were 65 millimeters thick, which was perfect for as a brick course. And so we got this strong horizontal feel, very solid, almost like a sort of the exact opposite of the sort of corrugated tin architecture they had up till then. Next. There's this scrumptious corner where the circle meets straight and becomes a sort of wafer-thin building, which somehow we got through value engineering and everything else. Extraordinary to think about it now. Next. I think it's because they're only allowed to build a certain amount of offices and there had to be a gross net. It was all set. We met it. We just met the amount of office, and we met the gross net, so they accepted that we got this insane wall, which was wafer thin, and we did have to put a boiler on the end, of course, because although you can design things for cars, you can't trust them not to knock down your building. Next. This is a Bristol car, of course, because it's in Bristol. Enjoy taking photographs as well, almost as much as your receptionist. Next. There's an interior, it's a bit sort of, how should we say, a bit Ted Cullen-ish, but nice. Next. Then we did this for Bryanston. This is Norman Shaw, and we decided to have a riff on Norman Shaw and his red brick and his alternating stone and brick, and then we, because it was for design and technology, and because it was a school, we put a mortarboard on it. Because it was technology, we put a screw. Until somebody pointed out we had six bastard screws, being the ones that go anti-clockwise. That's a bastard screw. As it happens, the Bastard brothers that designed local classical buildings, so we claimed it was a reference then, next. And it kind of fitted with the building, and it was great fun to do, actually. And one of the Conrad sons actually designed these doors. He was at school at the time. Next. We won a master plan to do... This was our breakthrough into master planning. Which we planned Crown Street, and it finally got built. This is, of course, 10 years later. It took 10 years to actually build 1,000 houses, which is kind of depressing, but we did do this master plan with big, big gardens and a park and all the things that sort of like importing made avail into into Glasgow. Yeah, I can't go on. Next, you go. Okay, finally, yes, Janet Street Porter's house, which is a sort of cheap and cheerful house of the mid-80s. Janet was at college with me and commissioned this house. She also knew Frank Geary really well, and Frank said, I'll design your house for you. And unbelievably, she said, no, I think I'll stick to Piers. God knows what this house would be worth now if she had given it to his blandishments. But anyway, I put a fish in anyway, because Frank was into fish at the time, so I put a big, big, big fish on the outside. And something of a portrait of the client at the same time. This is in Clerkenwell, which at that time was fairly run down, actually, not full of bright young things. It was sort of prosaic. There was a sort of gay park across the road. And I had to build a building out of bricks and some concrete floors and so on. And this is W20 window sections in the same way. In this case, new rather than replacement. I went to the lovely cook shop on Edgware Road. It used to be there, a huge cook shop, but it's still there. And I went and bought two cake molds that said two fours to put on the house at the end. And the woman at the checkout said, could always use the 1-4 twice. And instead of saying, well, it's a house number, actually, I was too nervous. I said, oh, and now I'm just in a hurry. Next. This was a meditation on the London Building Acts. Most of you won't remember the London Building Acts, but they were the building rates for London that still had memories of the fire of London. It's sort of buried in those building acts. And one of the edicts of the building acts, and it's incredibly pertinent to think about it, was that you couldn't have inflammable materials of any kind on the outside of the building except timber frame windows and shop fronts. They were the only timber allowed onto the outside of buildings in London after the fire of London. And so, as a weird riff on this, they just at that moment in 1985 or so, they changed from the London Building Acts in London to the building rates to across the country. And so we were allowed at that moment to put timber lintels over windows. And I thought, I'm going to put a timber lintel over the window, but I'm going to make it of concrete to show that I really preferred the London Building Acts to the new building rates. So this is nostalgia for the London Building Acts, personified. Janet's a great rambler, loves the countryside, and that's the real reference there. I'm going to show you some insides, because why not? It's fun, and it's the end of the talk. This is her bed on wheels. This is how it's constructed. It's a bit of polished plaster. That's a bit of work. Next. This is her billiards room with the same lino cut, the fancy cut lino that Terry was using. I discovered for the Lutyens exhibition in 1981, and we had Janet had this wonderful Joe Tilson image, and we just redid it as it were on the floor. It was a great moment. She had a billiards room. Gosh, she was that kind of lady. Next. This was the old My Office reception desk, which also, actually, we had complaints about the vision under the desk. And I had to make a modesty panel for it. But for Janet, when Janet got hold of it, after we threw it out, Janet got hold of it, and we took the modesty panel away again. Next. And Janet had a great collection of art. Next. Next. Up this good balcony. This is really why she had to move, because everybody shouted at her when she sat in the balcony. Yes. And this roof is rather spectacular in the Clerkenwell Sea. You see, it was all quite run down, and it's all been replaced now. But this, we had a lot of trouble planning with that, of course, but we got it in the end. Next. It's Janet, wearing Arabelle on, looking great. That's from the 80s.
Yes.
Next. And her wigwam. Well, powwows with Alan Camp. And some great guy made this out of old kitchen utensils. Old Patrick, he lived in our next. And finally, we moved into our offices in that decade and had two more of the columns made from Bryanston, just in case anyone thought they were contextual. We proved they weren't, because they looked just as good in Clerkenwell. except we painted them gold, because you can't be too truthful to materials, it can get rather dull. And we also painted our oak frame windows bronze, in case anyone might think we were couldn't afford bronze, you know, windows, we can. And that's where we still are, we're still in the same building, so rather like you. We made our pitch, we bought this building happily way back then, and we're still there. Thank you.
We're still working with, can we have the lights on? We're still working together. And over here is the Old Oak Common scheme that you're doing,
yeah.
Which is part of the master plan we're doing for the client you did.
Yeah. Arsenal.
Yeah.
Yeah, we switched football clubs.
Yes.
Yeah. Not really supposed to.
Yes. We didn't have questions last time, but do you want to ask questions? Come on.
Let's ask questions. Or comments. Good.
You mentioned the small places like the newspaper stands and the other places causing a lot of money.
Newspapers or flower stand or photo meet booths, as they were then, or whatever, you could get a good rental from. And that made the difference to the financial viability of the place. Mm. And when Piers's toilets, which was funded primarily by John Scott, but also by the local council.
Oh yeah, the local council put up most of the money, and the local residents put up a bit, but enough to add this flower kiosk.
But it didn't quite stack up until I suggested, because of East Putney, why not do a flower stand? And that was really good, because toilets and flower stands go well together.
They do, and they take the whiff.
It's
said that Wilde Park, which is the florist there, turns over £2 million a year.
Oh my God.
So they pay a very fancy rent to the council, and the more that looks after the orchard, do the lavatory and the attendant and all.
And Piers got the Kensington Chelsea Award that year.
Yeah, I got one from the Royal Fine Art Commission.
But you also got one from.
I did. From Kensington Chelsea gave me an award. Yeah.
And you invited me along.
Yeah.
And which it was. A very nice occasion.
You said the land gave a speech.
Yes.
About kidney juices.
Did you?
Yes. It was a poem, I think it was.
Any other questions?
Many of your projects, it seems that you got to a very, very developed detail or spoke element that you designed from interior to or egg cups, and do you think there's a point at which that became increasingly difficult to do, or do you think it has to do with trend or with clients, or just?
I think there was a prejudice against, a British prejudice against anything that smells of excess. TVAM got into financial difficulties for a short while. It then recovered, but I remember at a reception in TVA, I met one of the bankers from the City of London, and he said, what have you done at TVA? Why are you? I said, I'm the architect. He said, oh, you're blamed for our financial difficulties. I said, this is the cheapest television studio almost ever built. And the land cost this, and the money cost that. And then he thought for a while. He said, He said, it's not that it's not that it's expensive, but you made it look expensive. And I thought that was interesting comment, because Lloyd's was just built about the same time. And Lloyd's is the most expensive building almost ever built in Britain. It had stainless steel toilets and lifts, and yet all those bits are utilitarian to the British mind. They're all functional, they're toilets, they're lifts, but we have done bright colours. And if you value engineered the egg cups out and the lettering and all the rest of it, you'd have had an even cheaper building. So there's a kind of purism.
I'm going to ask you a similar question, Mr. Terry. Do you think you agree with what Piers said? Is it the 80s, the 60s, brought into architecture? Because TVA had some connection